We're traveling through a dimension both of sound and ideas. We're at a place where the mind can comprehend and devise a solar radio, a wireless transmitter, measure time and light. 65 electronic projects brought to reality with this science fair kit. Astonishing? Perhaps. But you can find it for Christmas, for $17.95, in a place that's known as Radio Shack.
Radio, stereos, recorders, everything in sound.
Where are we?
Right now you're in a kind of a limbo. You're neither here nor there.
Where are we?
Between light and shadow.
Hey gang, season's greetings and all that stuff. I'm Craig, and this is Between Light and Shadow, a Twilight Zone podcast, and you've dialed in to our second annual holiday special. I'm recording this on the morning of December 24th, 2017, Christmas Eve. Outside, there's a bit of a snowstorm brewing, ivory flurries dancing inside swirling currents of winter air. My office gets hella hot while I'm recording. Probably all that hot air, I'm guessing. So I've got my window open just a bit. I'm not sure if the mic is going to pick any of that up, but if it does, instant free background ambiance. And if you can't hear it, hopefully you'll at least hear the spirit coming through in my voice. And if nothing else, the spirits I'm imbibing will likely come through loud and clear. So here we are again, another Christmas. Now, the Twilight Zone only had one real Christmas episode, Season 2's Night of the Meek. I mean, there are other episodes that have some level of tangential connection to Christmas, like The Changing of the Guard and Five Characters in Search of an Exit, but Night of the Meek has friggin' Santa Claus in it, and it takes place on Christmas Eve. It's positively dripping with Christmas cheer, and it's on my short list of annual viewings every December. Thing is, we covered it last year. And in doing so, we violated our format, since our focus is supposed to be the first season of The Twilight Zone. That's the first and only time we've not covered a season one episode. Well, so far. Who knows what the future might hold? But we are not violating our format this year. Turns out there's a season one episode that isn't explicitly Christmas related, but it does feature a Santa type character just the same. Not only that, but it first aired December 25th, 1959. That's right, on Christmas Day. Of course, I'm talking about What You Need. City street, night. I see two neon signs, Smitty's and Del Rio. Del Rio totally sounds like a cheap motel, and Smitty's totally sounds like a neighborhood bar. But aha! The Twilight Zone, notorious for its twists and turns and surprises, is instead showing us events unfolding in the Del Rio cocktail bar.
You're looking at Mr. Fred Renard, who carries on his shoulder a chip the size of the national debt. This is a sour man. A friendless man, a lonely man, a grasping, compulsive, nervous man. This is a man who has lived 36 undistinguished, meaningless, pointless, failure-laden years, and who at this moment looks for an escape. Any escape. Any way, anything, anybody to get out of the rut.
You ready for another?
I'm fine.
You've been fine for an hour. We sell booze here, mister. We don't just rent space.
Is that a fact?
That's a fact, buddy.
How would you like to take a flying jump at the moon?
All kinds. We get all kinds.
The bartender is played by William Edmondson, who looks like he was probably a character actor in a ton of old movies and TV shows, but his resume is only comprised of 17 credits, and he's probably best remembered for his work right here, as well as in the Season 2 Twilight Zone episode Shadow Play, where he played death row inmate Jiggs.
Phillips! Send your face!
A month ago, he was a human being. Now what is he? An animal, a thing. Why? Because he couldn't stop thinking about it.
I know it. It's just different with me.
You mean you want to die?
No.
Well, it ain't different with you. But don't kid yourself. Sometimes I wonder, too, what it's going to be like.
Edmondson died in 1979 at the age of 78, so this isn't one of those cases where an actor dies tragically before their time. I'm not sure why he didn't act more. Maybe he wasn't really bitten by the acting bug. Maybe he was just lightly nibbled. The actor on the other side of the bar had a very different story. Fred Renard, who, as Serling has already told us, is literally the biggest asshole to ever walk the planet, is played by Steve Cochran. He's probably best remembered for his Warner Brother films like White Heat with James Cagney in 1949 and The Damned Don't Cry with Joan Crawford in 1950. But for further insight, I'm going to let IMDb do the talking. This is from his bio written by Gary Brumberg. Husky, hirsute, darkly handsome Steve Cochran was all man, and a slick ladies' guy to boot. They didn't come much rougher and tougher than he, both off and on camera. Throughout post-World War II Hollywood and the 1950s, he played the swarthiest and sexiest of cold-hearted villains, with mustache or without, in a few films now considered classics. What Cochran perhaps lacked in the Gable charisma department, he certainly made up for with his own raw magnetism and sexy virility, though it wasn't enough for him to attain all-out superstardom. Perhaps a few too many oily heavies and shady heroes for audiences to really warm up to was the key problem. And with his womanizing reputation preceding him, the tabloids could not have dreamed up a more salacious and mysterious ending for this cinematic bad boy in 1965 than amid a crew of lovely Mexican ladies. In 1965, Steve hired an assortment of ladies for an all-girl crew to accompany him on a boating trip to check out locations for an upcoming film he was to produce and star in entitled Captain O'Flynn. Leaving Acapulco on June 3rd, the boat encountered extremely stormy weather and Steve's health, which was not good in the first place. He took ill while filming in Mozambique and failed to see a doctor, quickly took a turn for the worse. He died of an acute lung infection and was dead for nearly a week when his drifting schooner and the girls, one of whom was several years underage, was rescued from the ocean near Guatemala on June 21st. A fitting, if not troubling, end for the one-time He-Man Hollywood star. Steve Cochran was 48 years old when he died. I just turned 48 a few weeks ago, but luckily I'm neither swarthy nor sexy. I may be an oily heavy, though. Jury's still out on that one. I like to think it is, anyway.
And this little old man is just what Mr. Renard is waiting for.
We won't hear his name until way into the episode, but the old man is called simply Padot. Playing him is Ernest Truex, who will return to the Twilight Zone as an unhappy man in a retirement home who discovers the secret of eternal youth in Season 3's Kick the Can.
There is magic in the world. I know there is. When I fell in love with Mary and kissed her for the first time,
that was magic.
When my boy was born, that was magic. Friendship is a magic thing. Maybe I'm right, Ben. Maybe Kick the Can is the greatest magic of all.
His film career dates back to 1913, which I think probably makes him the oldest Twilight Zone actor we've seen so far. So the old guy shows up at the Del Rio cocktail bar with a suitcase-looking thing, probably the exact same one used by Louis J. Bookman in One for the Angels, since both are peddlers. This is a frequent stop of his, we'll come to find out in just a bit. He starts with an attractive young woman sitting alone in a booth and lands his first potential sale.
I guess I need some matches.
I'll tell you what you need. Cleaning fluid. Oh, very good cleaning fluid. Guaranteed to remove spots of any and all kinds.
Ooh, yeah. That might play very differently today. A woman in need, and what she really needs is cleaning fluid? You know, to clean stuff like women do? I mean, you could get away with this in 1959, but now? You'd get crucified on social media for outdated, porcine chauvinism.
You pig!
The young lady is none other than Arlene Sachs, who is pretty much television sci-fi royalty. She played T'Pring, the Vulcan princess betrothed to Spock on Star Trek. She also turned in a great performance as Consuela Biros, opposite Robert Culp, in the Outer Limits classic Demon with a Glass Hand.
I believe you. Where did he go? What did you do to him?
He went forward to another time, 1,000 years from now. The future. He came from the future, and so do I.
But you said that he wasn't human, that he was some other kind of being.
Another world and another time.
Look, I work late tonight. It's a poor living. Will you let me go home, please?
By then, she was known as Arlene Martell, but here she was still, sexy. Her appearance here is the first of two trips to the Twilight Zone. She's much more memorable, or maybe notorious, as the morgue nurse in Season 2's 22.
Room for one more, honey.
And I'd be completely and utterly remiss if I failed to point out that she is, in fact, a genuine TZ babe.
A chick that won't quit. It's like stacked, like beautiful.
You got me straight tripping, boo.
So our elderly peddler friend makes his way to the bar, where he finds a forlorn young man named Lefty.
Tell him, Lefty. Tell him what you need. The old coot comes in here every night bugging everybody. He's got what they need. Tell him what you need.
Here we see that oily, no-account bastard Fred Renard prick up his ears. Serling didn't mention that he was also an unrepentant eavesdropper. He probably kicks stray dogs and cheats on his taxes, too. Jerkwad.
What do you need?
A new left arm.
A new left arm?
Yeah, Lefty was quite a pitcher in his time. He pitched for a couple of years for the Cubs. Then his arm went sour. I ought to know. I dropped a bundle on him on a Sunday a couple of years ago.
What do you do now?
What does he do now? He comes in here 7 nights a week, looking for a baseball career at the bottom of the bottle.
But hey, no hard feelings, right, Lefty? Right? I'm just going to serve you drinks and fuck with you about it every chance I get. You know, I'm no bartender, but it seems pretty cruel to openly mock your customers about their alcoholism.
You dick!
What do you got, pup?
Many things. Many odds and ends. Things you need.
Things I need. Well, what do you think I need, pup?
Luckless Lefty is played by Reed Morgan. Not really a name you hear much, but he had a long career in Hollywood. His credits span from 1949 to 1994. And Outer Limits fans rejoice, he was the guy inside the hysterically bad Adam Link costume in iRobot. Plus, he was one of the guys playing poker at the beginning of Fun and Games.
I think I know what it is you need.
Bus ticket to Scranton, Pennsylvania.
Just then, Lefty gets a phone call. You know, you're probably spending way too much time at the bar if people are calling you there. Maybe they should put in an extension down there in the bottom of the bottle just for you. Oh, shit. Now, I'm doing it. So Lefty heads over to the phone booth and talks to his folks, who swear they never had a son named Lefty, and then he disappears and... wait, wrong... episode. Lefty's talking to somebody. We don't know who, but he's smiling. He comes back to the bar with some good news.
Ah, crazy. Real crazy. Old manager of mine, been looking for me for 3 weeks. Got me a job. Coaching job. Minor league club in Scranton, Pennsylvania. He wants me to take a bus there. How about that? How'd you know, Pop?
Coincidence, maybe. Or just good fortune. But why question it? It's there for you. You just take it.
Meanwhile, his holy swarthiness is there in the background, taking it all in. The clunky wheels in his oily head are clearly turning. Lefty, meanwhile, notices a stain on his jacket.
Gee, I wish I could get that thing out. I like to look halfway decent when I meet the general manager. That's who I'm going to meet, the general manager. I hate to look like a tramp. I can get a shave. That's the only coat I got.
And as if on cue, that sexy girl with the cleaning fluid shows up and takes the spot next to Lefty at the bar, since, you know, there's
room for one more, honey.
Excuse me, I couldn't help but overhear. Why don't you try this? It's supposed to be very good for that sort of thing.
Oh, I don't want to bother you, miss.
Oh, no, let me try.
All right.
Now, while she rubs the fluid into the stain on his jacket, we get a nice, ominous shot of Padot in the foreground and Renard in the background. Padot stiffens when he realizes that he's being watched. He turns and locks eyes with Renard. Renard goes right on staring, scowling, intimidating.
Thank you, miss.
It's all right.
I was lucky you were around.
Not really lucky. The old gentleman over there.
But he's gone, and they're free to fall in love and live happily ever after, now that their obligatory meet-cute scene is done. Aww. Outside on the street, Renard finds Padot and pounces. I mean, he figuratively pounces. He doesn't literally... You know what I mean.
Now, come on. What do I need? You tell me, old man.
One needs many different things.
Yeah, but what do I need now? Huh? What do I need tonight? What do I need?
Padot reaches into his case and hands Renard a pair of...
Scissors? What is this, some kind of gag?
There it is!
What kind of a gag is this?
I don't know, it's just a gag, maybe.
Is it some sort of a gag?
Just a little gag.
This is a gag or something?
Somebody's trying to pull a gag.
This is a gag, isn't it?
All right, what's the gag?
Gag me with a spoon!
That right there is the single most prevalent common reaction to the various bizarre and confusing goings-on in the Twilight Zone. And as I threatened recently, we now have a jingle for it. So expect to hear that one again, probably sooner rather than later.
I want you to level with me, old man. I mean it. Don't spread you all over the street.
Dick!
They're what you need. They really are.
Renard takes the scissors and goes back to his hotel. Now, he's wearing a big, long scarf, which promptly gets caught in the elevator door.
Hey!
Oh, that's not good. Yeah, that might just,
Help!
As the elevator ascends, the scarf progressively tightens around his neck. Doom seems imminent. And then he remembers the scissors. He whips them out and cuts the scarf off just in the nick of time, saving himself from certain strangulation and denying us the sick pleasure of watching a certified prick choke to death right before our eyes. But I guess a gruesome death wouldn't be appropriate for a family-friendly Christmas episode.
Yeah, that's just what I needed.
Then we're in Padot's apartment in the middle of the night. The lights are all off, and somebody sits smoking in the dark. But it's not Padot. Padot enters, flips on the light, and spills his case all over the place, startled. It's that paunchy, greasy, sweaty sumbitch Renard.
Mr. Fred Renard.
Yeah. Who's that lounging in my chair? Who's that casting deep fear stares in my direction? Mama, this surely is a dream. Yeah. Yeah, mama, this surely.
It was a nice pair of scissors I got from you tonight. Yeah, they saved my hide. What do you got in there? Some kind of machine? Crystal ball? You can see ahead, can't you? You can look into the future. You poor dummy. You got $1 million talent in you. You dribble it away on nickels and dimes. You want to know something? You got a partner now.
Padot tries to reason with him.
I don't need a partner. I don't need anything. I'm content. I have this talent, but I use it sparingly. I must use it sparingly.
Shockingly, Renard isn't moved in the slightest.
Now, come on, concentrate. Go into a trance or whatever you do and tell me what I need to know for tomorrow. What's for the next day? What's for Wednesday? Now, come on, old man, concentrate. What do I need?
Oh, he's clearly not going to leave the poor old guy alone. Padot produces a fountain pen, not from his case, but from inside his jacket.
A pen? What is this, a gag or something?
What? Twice in one episode?
What kind of a gag is this?
I don't know. It's just a gag, maybe.
Is it some sort of a gag?
Just a little gag.
This is a gag or something?
Somebody's trying to pull a gag.
This is a gag, isn't it?
All right, what's the gag?
Gag me with a spoon.
A leaky pen. I'm supposed to need a leaky pen, is that it? Pen that drips all over
the pen leaks ink onto a newspaper on the floor.
Hey, this is wild. This is really wild. Look, it dropped right alongside of a horse's name. Staunch soldier runs in the first race tomorrow. Hey, old man. You're all right. That's what I needed, all right.
Renard scores big at the track the next day, so naturally he's going to try it again with tomorrow's paper. We only get a quick glimpse of it, but the headline on the front page reads, H-bomb capable of total destruction. This is the same newspaper Henry Bemis was reading in the bank vault in Time Enough at Last. So if all Twilight Zones exist in the same universe, which I really, really want them to, and this is tomorrow's newspaper, that means Henry Bemis won't be reading it until noon the next day, by which time the events of this episode will be over. So yeah, I'm going to take the appearance of this newspaper as confirmation that What You Need and Time Enough at Last do in fact exist in the same universe. Okay, so Renard opens the newspaper to the sports page, spreads it out on the floor, and holds the pen over it expectantly. But no ink drops out. The pen is bone dry.
Why, that old crumb bomb.
He finds the old man outside on his usual street corner. The sidewalk is shiny, like it's been raining recently. Renard approaches him from behind slowly, like a predator.
That pen, it don't work. No ink comes out. I can't pick any winners.
Well, you won a great deal, Mr. Renard. Things you need, you only need once.
Okay. What's next, then?
Nothing is next. I'd rather not sell you anything more.
I just want you to keep supplying me with what I need. I don't care what it is. Scissors to save my lousy hide or a leaky fountain pen so I can pick winners. But whatever it is, I want it to keep coming. I don't want it to stop.
That's a pity. Because it must stop. It must stop now.
Renard's just not hearing him at all. He grabs Padot by the lapels.
Now look. Look deep. Look deep and tell me what's for tomorrow. You can see ahead, I know you can. Now look deep. What do you see?
A look of fear passes over the old man's face, but he refuses to comply. Renard starts rummaging around in Padot's case until he lands on a cardboard box.
Please, please don't.
Jackpot. Renard opens the box to find a pair of...
shoes?
He sits down on the curb and eagerly puts the shoes on, like a kid on Christmas. And as he does, the old man moves slowly to the other side of the street.
His shoes are too tight. They got leather soles. I hate leather soles. They're slippery. But they're what I need, aren't they? I put them on and then I walk someplace. Is that it? I walk someplace where I find what I need. Well, what's with it, old man? What happens? I'm waiting.
Patience. That's another thing that you need, Mr. Renard. Patience.
What are you doing? Give me the business? Is that what you're doing? Give me the business? You know, I can come over there and take you apart bone by bone.
You dick!
Come on, old man, tell me. Are these what I need?
I didn't say they were. But I'll tell you something. They happen to be what I need.
That's it. No more Mr. Nice Guy. I mean, he's never been a nice guy, but you get what I mean. Renard starts to cross the street, clearly intending to start wailing on the old man. He's about halfway across when he starts to lose his footing on the slippery pavement. And as if on cue, a car comes screaming around the corner, plows right through him, and continues on without slowing down or stopping. Padot looks down at his paunchy, greasy, sweaty corpse.
What I saw in your eyes at that bar was death. My death. You were going to kill me. So what was needed for Mr. Renard was slippery shoes. That's what was needed. Slippery shoes.
A crowd quickly gathers as Renard's body is loaded into an ambulance.
What happened? Did anybody see it?
Did you see it?
Hit and run. That's what it was. Can I sell you something tonight, sir?
Are you kidding, old-timer? What would I need?
I'll tell you what you need. This is what you need. It's yours. No charge tonight.
Padot hands the man a comb and walks off into the night. A photographer is making the rounds, snapping pics of the crime scene.
Will you please hold it, folks? I'd like to take your picture.
For goodness sake, try to make yourself presentable. Our picture's going to be in the paper. The comb!
The ambulance drives away, and on the sidewalk sits a pair of slippery shoes.
Street scene, night. Traffic accident. Victim named Fred Renard. Gentleman with a sour face to whom contentment came with difficulty. Fred Renard, who took all that was needed in the Twilight Zone.
What You Need was written by Rod Serling and adapted from a short story by Louis Paget. Louis Paget wasn't a real guy. He was a nom de plume used by married writers Harry Kuttner and C.L. Moore. In the director's chair is Alvin Ganzer, who also directed The Hitchhiker, one of my all-time favorites. Ganzer directed a total of 4 Twilight Zones, all in season 1. The other two were Nightmare as a Child and The Mighty Casey. The direction here is fine, workmanlike, not particularly stylish, but it gets the job done. It's not one of the more fantastic or elaborate Twilight Zones, so I guess it doesn't really call for a Douglas Hayes-style lavish production. That bit where Renard gets mowed down by the hit-and-run driver is the exception. It's really quick, visceral. The only thing it's missing is that well-worn Bernard Herrmann shock stinger cue from the Moat Farm murder. The Twilight Zone often serves to nudge lost souls along, perhaps providing them with a circumstance or a magical object to motivate them. On the other hand, the Twilight Zone also exists to punish the wicked in a savage but ironic fashion. Padot is the physical embodiment of both facets of the Twilight Zone. He likes you. He wants to help you. Oh wait, you're a dick? In that case, he's gonna sort you out. What You Need is really 2 stories, divided neatly at the act break. The first half feels kinda like a fairy tale, with this friendly old guy popping into people's lives at just the right moment when they need something. Some seemingly insignificant thing that will lead them to a major turning point in their lives. This could almost be a pilot for a series. Each week, the old man gives a different thing to a different person, and their story plays out. Sometimes it's a happy ending, sometimes, not. Like here, things seem to take a dark turn when Renard starts putting the pinch on him. But this is the Twilight Zone, so it could be that we're about to see some kind of redemption story unfold. Maybe what Renard really needs is a push in the right direction. In fact, his close call in the elevator could have been some kind of near-death, life-changing experience, and it is kind of wonderful to see him laughing after 15 minutes of sheer assholery. We cut to a commercial on something of an ambiguous note. This could really go either way. But it becomes very clear very quickly that Renard isn't a changed man at all, and the second half of the story is much darker. Even the music, an original score by Nathan Van Cleve, exhibits that dual nature. And you know what an original music score means around here.
Music, professor!
Hello?
Hey, Doc, it's Craig.
Hey, what's up?
You know, it's Christmas. Christmas time. That's always exciting. I know you and I had an extended conversation about a year ago. about the holidays. Obviously, we covered Night of the Meek last year, which is the only true Christmas episode of the Twilight Zone. But as I pointed out a little bit ago, what you need is Christmassy enough on its own terms. So that's what we're doing this year for the holiday special extravaganza episode.
Nice.
I was kind of observing that the episode is really kind of two stories. It's kind of one thing. And then about halfway through, it kind of veers off and it becomes something different. And the first half is kind of a lighter Padad is kind of, you know, floating around into other people's lives and he's giving them things. And you have this whole little cute meeting with Lefty and I don't think they ever give her a name. The girl, Arlene Sachs. And it's kind of like, it's really unclear like where this thing's going to go. I mean, we've got Renard and he's obviously not a nice guy, but when we come back for commercial is when it really kind of starts getting dark. So I was just observing that the musical score kind of goes along with that because at, in the first half you have these kind of really kind of sparkly cues almost, I would say. And then later we don't really get much of that. It's more just kind of more ominous dramatic stuff. So my first question to you, what is making those sparkly sounds?
What is making those sparkly sounds? That would be a celesta.
Ooh, okay. And because in my head, I'm thinking of like some kind of like electronic harpsichord type of thing. Am I completely wrong?
No, kind of. It's a keyboard instrument.
Okay. And is that something that was used commonly?
Oh, yeah, absolutely. Oh, really? Even in orchestral music, sometimes, like Béla Bartók's music for strings, percussion, and celeste was a very famous piece in the 20th century. So, yeah, and it's one of those things where a lot of orchestral composers would start using instruments, and then film and TV composers started to follow suit.
Mm, okay. And it's celesta, not celesta.
Right,
because that's how I would say it. And in my head, it makes sense because like, oh, it's like a celestial sort of a sounding, you know, it's kind of like a kind of like a mystical sort of a sound. I don't know if the use of it here is representative of how it normally sounds. I mean,
yeah.
Okay. So is it kind of a thing where, you know, a lot of electronic keyboard instruments, you can do a lot of different things with them. Is it kind of like this is how it always sounds, the celesta?
Yeah, actually. Okay. I'm sorry.
Are you ill?
No, I'm just all froggy.
All froggy. Okay.
It's got about a 5-octave-ish range. Mm-hmm. So it's not as wide-ranging as, say, a piano, which has 88 keys.
Okay. This is the first Van Cleve score, I think. I feel like I should know that off the top of my head. I think it is. I think it's his first. Oh, wait. No. Hang on. He did Perchance to Dream, didn't he?
Oh, right. Yes, it's true. Right. I forgot about
that. This is the second one.
Although you have to remember, too, that the order in which it aired was not always the order in which it was recorded / composed.
I'm going to need to look that up and see which one of them was actually... Well, even... I mean, I can get as far as production order, but that still isn't going to tell me like when they were recorded.
Actually,
have that, right?
I do. Let me just check in my handy dandy book. You know, you've made it when you have to refer to your own book.
I had Steve Rubin on a couple of weeks ago, and I had him consulting his own copy of his own book, too. So there's a precedent.
It's also kind of annoying when you need to search for something and like all you find is your own stuff.
So, okay. If you Google outer limits meme, 90% of it's mine.
Oh, God.
And I'm simultaneously horrified, but also kind of tickled by it. So.
So What You Need was recorded on December 9th, 1959, from 9 a.m. to 12:15 p.m.
Oh, I was hoping for something a little more specific than that, but all right.
And Perchance to Dream was recorded previously. So that was okay. December 1959, from 7:30 a.m. to 11:30 a.m.
Wow. So that's just a few weeks until the episode aired. Wow. I didn't realize they cut it that close. That's really interesting.
Usually they recorded it about 2 weeks or so before it aired.
Oh, okay. Wow. So aside from the celesta, what else is notable about this score?
So Van Cleef writes a little melody, which is something that we would call in music a leitmotif, or a motive that keeps coming back that's associated with something or someone. Mm-hmm. And this is a cello melody that is in the second act opening cue. And every time Padot finds something that somebody needs, whether it's a bus ticket to Scranton, Pennsylvania, or some glove cleaner, this little melody comes out. So it's kind of his little, you know, introduction into, oh, I have something for you. Mm-hmm. And so as the episode starts to kind of go darker and darker, because what's his face? See, my brain is not working either.
Fred Renard.
Renard is a jerk.
That's putting it mildly, but all right.
Yeah. That starts to fade away. Mm-hmm. And what you get is more and more reverberation. Van Cleef loved using the organ. He used it in a lot of his Twilight Zone scores. Mm-hmm. And when you have that organ, he starts to use a lot of reverberation to, number one, give you this sense of something weird is happening, and it's not good. We get a lot of that something weird is happening and it's not good with the reverb in Midnight Sun. Piano. So anytime something becomes more and more serious, he loves to use reverberation. And he loves to use it with either a piano or an organ. In this case, he's using it with the organ. What I like to call the vision theme, or the theme that happens anytime he tells somebody they need something, that slowly starts to fade away. Mm-hmm. So by the time you get to the end where you get like new shoes, where he gives him the shoes that kill him, then you don't have any of that anymore.
Right. It's a lot more just like traditional. I mean, it's almost like almost film noir type scoring, where it's just this very like kind of an ominous, heavy kind of thing, which probably describes me.
Well, the other thing he does is he also uses something called a mix master, which is something that he uses with the organ to change what we call the timbre or the tone color. So he's using the mixmaster at the end when he gives Renard the shoes and Renard gets hit by the car, and he says, I saw something and I know what I needed. He makes the mixmaster color the organ to sound like bells.
What, this is fascinating. What exactly is a mixmaster? Is it like a piece of gear that like processes something like,
exactly,
like an echoplex or something like that?
Yeah.
Okay.
Very similar. Yeah.
God, wow. That's cool.
So, yeah. He actually writes in the score that he wants the mixmaster to give the organ a quote, somewhat ugly color. So like by the time you get the cue where Renard gets hit by the car, which is called The Vision Comes True. Mm-hmm. That's where he actually wants the mix master to make the organ sound ugly.
And this, of course, is one of many, many Twilight Zone scores that never got a soundtrack release. But nerds like us can get it anyway if we have the DVDs or the Blu-rays, because many, many of these scores are available on isolated tracks. Not all of them, but lots of them. I think we talked previously that Time Enough at Last is one that you just can't get anywhere.
Right.
But pretty much going forward from there, I think almost every original score is available on those until you get to season 5. Then there's like several that aren't.
Right.
But I have said many times I'm kind of obsessive about Twilight Zone music, even though I have no actual musical education. I still really respond to it. And this is one of my favorites. This and Midnight Sun are two of my absolute favorite scores.
Oh, Midnight Sun is my absolute favorite.
Yeah. And I love that. I really do. I like this. I like the different tones. You know, you've got these really kind of bright, you know, happy music. and then you've got like the other end of the spectrum. There's not a lot in the middle. It's just kind of
either or. But I love that about it. And I guess I could say that, you know, this podcast is between light and shadow, and the score represents both of those things. God, that sounded better in my head.
it always does.
So Doc, it's Christmas time. What are you doing for the holidays?
Oh, not breathing.
Sighing. You're sighing.
Ugh. I am sighing. This is the time of year which we academics think of as being in grading jail. Where we're all stuck grading endless amounts of papers and exams and lots of things. And so I am longing for the day, which will probably come right around Friday, where I will no longer be doing any of those things for a while and catching up on my own stuff.
You get some time off, I'm assuming, right?
I do. I get about 3 weeks off. During my time off, I'm actually going to be going out to LA for the first time. I'm going to be spending all of July out there, which is exciting. And one of the things I'm going to be doing when I'm out there, aside from doing lots of research on my atomic bomb book, I'm also going to be finally going through the CBS papers at UCLA and going to see if there's anything that was missing from my studies in the Twilight Zone, because all of the production documents and scores and things are out there and they're not all cataloged greatly. So it's a matter of actually going through things. I'm kind of working on a bunch of different projects, one of which was one that I started, I don't want to think about this, but I started it 6 years ago on the Twilight Zone theme of all things.
Which one?
The Constant.
Okay.
And
wait, it's constant. It's not constant.
No.
Oh, I'm so uncultured. I've been saying constant my entire life. I knew he was French and I still never thought that. I wonder if it's pronounced differently. Oh dear.
So yeah, we're trying to figure out like exactly what happened, because there's about six different stories as to how that theme came about, and any papers that we can think of that might be around will probably be in those papers if they're around anymore. Like, I've been looking in France and nothing is anywhere. I was in contact with Constant's son. He donated everything that he had and none of the stuff was there. So I'm going to be going through lots and lots of old CBS production paperwork, which will be incredibly fun, especially when I'll be in warm weather and not in snowy cold New York.
So I might have misheard you there, because I thought you said July.
Yeah, I'm going in July. I got a research grant from UCLA to spend the whole month out there. And I'm actually going for the first time to start doing some research the first week of January.
Oh, okay. So you're going out there before then. Gotcha.
Yeah,
okay.
I'm going out there first week of January. In fact, I planned this research trip in January with a colleague of mine who also has to go out and do research. So she and I just said, we'll just split costs and things like that. And then I wound up getting notified that I got the research grant. So I'm like, hey, I don't have to push all of my research into 5 days. Right.
That's exciting. I mean, that's like kind of like an extended sort of a deal if you're out there for the whole month of July. That's really cool. I've been wanting for a really long time to get down to LA. You know, we have a couple of mutual friends down there. July seems really hot to me to go to LA.
Yeah. See, the problem that I'm having is that I have to spend a minimum of a month out there because of the terms of the grant.
Right.
And May, I'm still finishing up with classes. June, I have a couple of other things going on. August, I have things happening here and classes are starting. And so the only feasible time for me to get an entire month between June of 2018 and June of 2019 is July.
Yeah. If somehow I can make it down there in July, I probably owe you like a whole slew of drinks for all you've done for us here on the podcast. So I will be happy to pay up. But yeah, that's cool. Yeah, I'll have to see what I can do about that. Like I said, I've been trying to do this forever, and stuff just always comes up. I have a flipping teenager in the house, so there's always... In fact, she just got her driver's license the other day.
But... I was just saying, a flipping teenager who pulled out of the driveway for the first time.
Oh, did you see the video? yeah, listeners, my daughter Kendall, who has popped in on the podcast here and there, just got her driver's license a couple of days ago, and her mom posted a tearful video of her pulling out of the driveway by herself for the first time. Actually, no, that was just yesterday, because she was going Christmas shopping by herself.
Oh my God.
Yeah. So, you know, there's just always new expenses when you have a kid in the house. But in a couple of years, that's not going to be the case anymore. But
empty nesters.
Ooh, finally. See, like Teresa's dreading it. And I'm like, bring it on. Because we have three older kids that have, you know, aren't here anymore. So we there have been kids around for a really long time. And I'm kind of looking forward to just, you know, not having that. You know, there's nothing against my kids. I adore them. But, you know, hey, you know, I'm all for the whole grow up and do your own thing somewhere else thing. Well, Doc, as always, thank you for your time. You always have this way of bringing the brains to the podcast.
I'm the brains, you're the brawn. Is that what
it is? Well, sure. Okay. Well, sure. Let's say that. Sure. Okay. Anyone that knows me is going to be like, what? But yeah, okay. Sure. Let's call it that. All right. You have a happy, happy holiday.
You as well.
All right. Catch you later.
Bye. Bye.
Dr. Reba Wissner is the author of A Dimension of Sound, Music in the Twilight Zone, and We Will Control All That You Hear, The Outer Limits and the Aural Imagination. And she's a real mensch. One thing I rather stupidly forgot to bring up, there's a cue very early in the score, during the prologue, in fact, that wasn't used in the final episode. It was intended for the bit where Padot first enters the bar, entitled simply, The Old Man. It was apparently decided that the source music playing throughout the rest of the prologue should just continue till the commercial break, so the cue was left out. It was later used, however, in two episodes, Season 2's The Man in the Bottle and Season 3's Kick the Can. That second one makes perfect sense since, as we pointed out earlier, it starred Padot himself, Ernest Truex. So while it's not one of the more iconic Twilight Zones, What You Need holds its own pretty well. Can't really find anything major wrong with it. It's not necessarily a perennial holiday essential, but it would be a necessary component if you were to assemble a Twilight Zone Christmas mini marathon. It's Christmassy without being explicitly so. I give it 2 non-denominational mistletoes up. So I mentioned that What You Need is based on an existing short story. This is another one of those times when Tom Elliott already read the story over on the Twilight Zone podcast, so we kindly direct your attention over there if you'd like to hear it. See the show notes for a link. Now, interestingly, the Twilight Zone was not the first TV series to adapt the story. Tales of Tomorrow's take on What You Need first aired on February 8, 1952. That adaptation is much more faithful to the original Lewis Padgett story, and it goes a little something like this.
Tonight's Tales of Tomorrow, What You Need, starring William Redfield with Edgar Staley.
Incidentally, Edgar Staley would go on to co-star in the Season 1 Twilight Zone episode, Long Live Walter Jameson. Okay, so we open on a shop called Peter Talley's Curios. A sign over the front door reads, "I have what you need." A man enters, purchases a pistol for $5,000, and promptly exits. There's another man outside, watching, skulking, writing something in a notebook. He then goes inside, where Peter Talley and his wife are minding the store.
Good evening, what can I do for you? Maybe you can tell me what I need.
Pardon?
Your sign says I have what you need. Well?
I'm sorry, Mr.
Carmichael, Tom Carmichael. I'm a freelance writer. I've been watching your store for a couple of days now.
Oh.
The past 2 days, I have seen people walk out of here with, let me see, an egg, a pair of rubber gloves, a test tube, and now a gun. Rather a weird assortment, wouldn't you say?
Carmichael clearly believes something nefarious is going on and threatens to go to the police, but Tally calls his bluff. So he tries a different tack.
Frankly, all I'm interested in is the story. Or let's put it another way. I see a sign which says, I have what you need. I'm a poor, struggling writer. But am I less in need than the wealthy-looking people that you serve?
Peter, I think the young man has a point.
You come to me then as a customer?
Well, yes, as a customer.
Will you excuse me a moment?
Tally disappears behind a curtain and sits down at an elaborate machine. He feeds it some information. It hums and whirs and does some high-tech processing. Then it spits out a slip of paper. Tally then retrieves a wrapped object from his stockroom and presents it to Carmichael. It's a pair of scissors.
This, Mr. Carmichael, is what you need. Carry it on your person.
Thank you. You know, I think I'm beginning to get your racket now.
You're an extremely intelligent young man.
You're some kind of phony medium. You spin a few dials and tell the future, and then you sell it at 5,000 per. It's quite a deal.
Good day, Mr. Carmichael. I must ask you to promise that you'll never come near my shop again.
Later that night, Carmichael's scarf gets stuck in a linotype machine at the newspaper where he works, and he narrowly escapes being strangled thanks to Tally's scissors. He returns to Tally's shop.
Shears came in handy.
You know what happened?
Yes.
How?
When you come in here, you're in the beam of my scanner. In my back room, I have a machine. By turning a calibrated dial, I can check on your possible futures. In one of these futures last night, I saw you killed by a printing press.
And in my other futures?
Let's say that I saw various possibilities depending upon how you react to different crises that arise.
Tell me what they are.
I can't do that.
Well, you do it for others.
It must be my own free choice. I stumbled on this power quite by accident. I was a scientist. I worked with electronics, and I dabbled with astrology. The pure science and the abstract hobby led me to this.
And then he proceeds to put the screws to the old man.
Publicity will ruin you, and I'm just the guy to do it. I subscribe to your service. My price for silence is the future. I want to know what tomorrow will bring. I want what I need.
I'd sooner wreck my machine.
Go ahead!
One of those men you saw, the one who gave me the check for $5,000, in 2 years, he'll develop a serum to combat polio. Without the gun I gave him today, he'd have been killed by a thief who's ransacking his apartment.
I'm not asking you to stop helping others. Just help me.
Peter, perhaps it's best to do as he says.
I'll send a messenger boy over with what you need.
Sorry I had to, use persuasion.
It's quite all right. I anticipated it.
You dick! I was wrong about him. He's evil.
I must check this at once. I must be certain. Absolutely certain.
Tally discovers that 2 weeks in the future, Carmichael will murder him and steal his machine. He solemnly has the aforementioned messenger boy deliver a package to Carmichael, who is getting plastered at a nearby bar. It's a pair of shoes. He eagerly puts them on, again, like a kid on Christmas, and heads for the door.
Take it easy, it's wet outside.
Now here, it happens off camera, but it's the exact same thing. Carmichael is mowed down by a speeding car.
I never had a chance. I swear, he slipped right in front of me, like he was pushed.
Back at the curio shop, Tally is an emotional wreck over what he's done. A radio broadcast reveals Carmichael's fate.
And now for the local news. Just a half hour ago, the snowstorm claimed its first casualty. A man identified as Tom Carmichael was instantly killed when he slipped beneath the wheels of a truck.
You could have saved him.
Worse, I sent him to his death.
He was evil, but death is for God to decide. You had no right.
And had I the right to step into the fate of all those others, to play God on earth? No mortal man has that right.
Oh, Peter, you've done so much good.
And tonight, I killed a man.
There must have been cause.
Yes, a cause. I saw it in the machine. A life for life, Tom Carmichael's for mine. In 2 weeks, he would have killed me and stolen the machine for his own evil gain.
But even so, you had no right.
I didn't ask for this terrible power. Oh, God, why was it granted me?
Tally proceeds to destroy his machine. Outside, the sign reading, "I have what you need," has inexplicably fallen into the snow. So this is our holiday special, but aside from Dr. Reba, who always elevates things around here, there hasn't really been anything special about this week's episode. Until right now. Kids, it gives me endless delight to bring out an unprecedented second guest. I don't think we've ever had two people show up in the same episode. Please give a warm round of applause for... Well, wait, I already recorded this, so I won't hear you clapping. But hey, do it anyway, because returning to the program is none other than Fred from the Twilight Pwn podcast. Fred, welcome back to Between Light and Shadow.
Hello. Hello. You were last on the show, I think it was like November of last year.
Yeah, something that sounds right.
Approximately.
It's a year anniversary of my first appearance.
it's a holiday here. yeah, you were in town with your band, and we actually were able to meet up in person and have a chat, and that was really fun.
Yeah, that was fun.
Other than the thoroughly embarrassing... unprofessional absence of monitoring headphones, which I'm still horrified about.
It's fine. It came out well.
So the Twilight Pwn is still kicking. It's
kicking is a funny word. I would say kind of flailing would be more my description for
crawling it. Crawling out of the wreckage. you're about like once a month, I think.
Yeah, I mean, again, that's a little generous, but yeah, we're in that realm. It's you know, it's been fun to kind of keep it doing. I think at this point, John and I kind of mainly do it just to stay in touch. But it's really fun. And we, you know, I don't, if listeners aren't familiar, you know, I'm from another Twilight Zone podcast from the distant past, and we finished the series, and now my co-host and I just kind of do random things, sometimes Night Gallery, sometimes the 80s Twilight Zone series. We did Planet of the Apes and got a lot of flack for it because we made fun of it. We're definitely kind of half-assing it as we go, but we're going to keep doing it because it's fun. So, yeah.
Well, first of all, everybody listening to this knows your podcast. I'm sure I don't believe there is a single person listening to this that doesn't also listen to yours.
It's a small world, Twilight Zone podcasting.
My God. I was just talking last week how many there are now. There are like 3 new ones.
Oh, wow, really?
There's like, I think, 11 or 12 like active Twilight Zone podcasts right now. It's damn. Insane.
Are most of them kind of like the general model of like, two dudes kind of riff around a thing? I mean, I'm not saying that like, that's good or bad. It's just like that's the default thing for a podcast. And certainly me and John are guilty of that.
Let me think. There's one where it's a couple of guys. And it's actually a little broader. I think they do anything Rod Serling. And then there's another one where it's like 3 brothers.
Whoa.
So that's
interesting.
That may be the first one with 3.
Huh. Yeah. All right.
But it's kind of amazing / frightening that there are that many of these.
I know, it's weird.
I don't know. I mean, I hesitated even doing mine because there were so many then.
Yeah, I mean, I think the cool thing about yours is not to get in a mutual trying to think of a
we are scratching PG-13, each other's backs big time.
Yeah, there we go. Back scratching. I was going to go a different place, but yeah, not to get into a back scratching exercise, but I mean, I think what I liked about yours is that it's just you, but you bring a lot of different guests, and there's kind of like a lot of old time radio type of sound effects and it's a little bit less like, hey, let's hang out and talk about the Twilight Zone, which is fine, but I think it's a little bit like, I don't know, diminishing returns, I guess.
Well, I mean, I want to you know, sit here and go on about my own thing, but I mean, I just wanted it to be something different. Which I guess it kind of is. I don't know.
Yeah.
I don't have time
to
listen.
Me and John were definitely kind of like, well, we're not British, so we're different than different than Tom's.
Oh, I love Tom's podcast, though.
It's so good. Yeah, it's funny because I didn't think I'd keep listening to it after we finished, just because I was like, I don't want to hear about the Twilight Zone, but I definitely do.
Cool.
Although, I mean, if the new Twilight Zone series is exciting and good, maybe John and I will kind of get more regular. How do you feel about it right now?
I'm reserving judgment. I mean, my initial reaction was, oh my God, no. Yeah. But and then I actually hadn't seen Get Out at that point.
Oh, yeah.
It was kind of like on the back of my head. It's like, I got to watch that movie at some point. My daughter had seen it. She said it was really good. So as soon as that news broke, I went and watched that. And I liked it. I thought it was pretty good.
Yeah, it's really good. And I think it's very, I mean, it's, there's a Twilight Zone-y element to it for sure.
Yeah, definitely. I mean, I think, you know, this happens every so many years. They decide to reboot this. And, you know, I mean, if it's going to be like Star Trek, where they just keep going back again, and sometimes it's good and sometimes it's not, all right. I mean, my thing is, it doesn't diminish the original. And if anything, it draws attention to it. Not that the Twilight Zone needs attention, because again, there are a dozen current podcasts on a 60-year-old show. So it's doing all right without the reboots. But I'm cautiously interested. Let's put it that way.
Yeah. I mean, I think it's weird because, like, with Star Trek, at least there's a universe that's preserved from series to series, and, you know, the rules change a little bit, but, like, basically, you know, the fundamental world that the series takes place in kind of stays the same. Mm-hmm. But with the Twilight Zone, it's weird because what exactly you mean when you say the Twilight Zone is, like, a lot more amorphous and kind of odd. Sure. Like, it's not a set of characters. Mm-hmm. The only consistent character was Rod Serling, and unfortunately he can't appear on the...
He's not available.
He's not currently... His agent is playing hardball on this one. And so I kind of feel like the things that attract me to it are like a complete package. There is like the sensibility of the original show, which they can sort of maybe try and recapture, but it's also the black and white, the fact that it's taking place in the 50s and 60s, and like... There's so much more to it, and I think that, like, you know, absent all of those factors, all you really have is like a series about stuff, crazy stuff that happens, and maybe there's a twist, and it's like, all right, like, that could be cool, it could be bad, but it's not why I love the Twilight Zone, you know.
I mean, ideally it would serve as a kind of reflection of the current time. You know, like,
yeah, but don't you feel like Black Mirror kind of already does that?
Well, yeah, and I mean, I was going to ask you if you're a fan of Black Mirror.
Yeah, I am. I mean, I'm not. I find, to be honest, some of it a little bit like, all right, social media is bad. I knew that. Like, cool. Like, I see where this is going. But like, it's just undeniably it's a pretty damn fun show, and sure. I like it a lot. And you know, I think it's like already kind of got the thing of like being a Twilight Zone type show grounded in technology, and that's maybe the most ripe ground for like a contemporary like shock or twister whoa type show. Yeah. So I don't know. I mean, I think your take is perfect, cautiously optimistic, but I'm definitely not like frothing at the mouth waiting for the apps to drop.
Fred, I said cautiously interested. I did not say optimistic.
Okay, sorry. Apologies. what you said, yeah.
So I had this idea. This was back when I was doing my Twilight Zone blog, and it was the show was turning 50. I had this idea that there would be a new Twilight Zone series, but it would be, the whole conceit of it would be that, so when the show was canceled, they had actually started work on the sixth season, and there were all these like lost episodes that had never surfaced. Mm-hmm. It would be black and white. It would be, I mean, everything about it would like mimic the original show, and it would like really be authentic in that respect. And
you mean like you'd make it now, but just under that premise or something? Yeah, that's kind of cool.
And I thought that was the coolest thing ever. I thought, oh my God, this has to happen. Obviously, that's never going to happen. But when they announced the new Jordan Peele thing, I was like, I got to get in a room with Jordan Peele. Someone's got to get to him immediately to tell him, like, someone's got to tell him, like, what it needs to be, you know? because there have been reboots, and they weren't like landmark, you know, they weren't like life changing.
Yeah,
this could be something great.
Yeah, I mean, I don't. It could be that. I mean, I don't think CBS has put any information out other than Jordan Peele is the one doing it. I mean, I don't know. It's tough because, like, you know, I think that's a cool idea, but it's also tough because it might just kind of come across like a sort of self-conscious nostalgia thing.
Oh, sure, totally. Oh,
or, but it also could be really cool. I mean, I just think it's like hard to know. You know, I think. In particular, it's like something like Star Trek. It's like, okay, well, you know, probably there's going to be a starship and you're going to take place in this world and here are the aliens and here's the general idea of the technology. But it's like, so it's like, well, what is the Twilight Zone? Is it the fact that it's the black and white and it's the time period, or is it the, and also even within the show, there's so much inconsistency. I mean, like, how do you reconcile, like, you know, Mr. Dingle the Strong with Eye of the Beholder? I mean, like, aside from Ron Serling, and it's black and white, and it's made at a certain time. Those are just could not be more different. You know
right,
what I mean?
Right.
In tone, I mean, everything's different. So it's hard to like recreate something like that.
Anyway, I think it's like a lightning in the bottle kind of thing. You know?
Yeah.
It's totally. You can't go back to that. I mean, you can try, and you may succeed sometimes. You may, you know, like with the 80s Twilight Zone, there were some good episodes of that.
Yeah, no, but for sure.
I don't know that I would think of them as Twilight Zone-y, you know. I just think there were some really good stories that they told. And yeah, I mean, it was the 80s. The special effects are ridiculously stupid, but there were some great stories.
Yeah.
And I feel like you can, I mean, I get why they do it, because it's the name recognition, you know. You're not going to make a show called, like, you know, Weird Stories and people are going to care, you know. It's the Twilight
totally
Zone. But anyways, so this is our second annual holiday episode, and we kind of blew our wad last year with Night of the Meek, so we're covering What You Need this year, which, as I mentioned earlier on the podcast, is kind of Christmassy. So knowing that you and I were going to talk, I broke one of my cardinal rules and listened to your episode on What You Need just like an hour or two ago. I just listened
to it.
And I usually, as a rule, avoid other Twilight Zone podcasts when I'm working on mine, because I don't, you know what I mean?
Yeah,
I mean,
yeah.
I listened to it before, but I mean, it's been over 3 years since you guys covered that. So I don't remember it, but I usually wouldn't want to listen to it right before I'm working on mine. So yeah, it's over 3 years ago. Do you even remember recording that one?
Well, I don't remember recording it. I don't remember what the weather was like the day of, but I remember talking about it. I mean, I remember, you know, obviously I know that you'd want to talk about it tonight, so that kind of like sent me down memory lane. I remember one of the most interesting things about do you want to talk about the episode?
Yeah, or no, that's fine.
Just I mean, I think it's really interesting how the episode starts and you're not really paying attention initially to Pedot and Renard. Is that correct? No, you're not paying attention to Renard initially, right?
Right.
Like, Renard is just like sitting there watching like an interaction with Pedot and the other characters happen, which is kind of like an interesting storytelling thing where it's like the main character is watching some secondary characters play out a little sub story before his story gets going, which I thought was cool.
Yeah, I almost feel like, in a way, it feels like a play, because if you had a play like that where you had multiple characters kind of in a communal environment, like a bar, you would have, I mean, that character would be sitting there and they might be, you know, listening to the conversation. And whenever I watch a Twilight Zone or rewatch a Twilight Zone, one of the things I always think of is, how would this translate to the stage? Because that's been kind of a thing. And it's actually a thing, like, right now. Like, there's a thing, I think it's in London, like, right now.
Right, yeah. Tom is talking about it on his podcast, yeah. This would be a good play one, I think, for sure.
At least the first half.
Well, yeah, when you get to the car accident, maybe not so much, but yeah.
Well, one of the things that I mentioned earlier in this episode is that it's really, like, two different stories. Like, you've got this whole thing first where it's kind of like this magical fairy tale and you know, Pedot's kind of going around from person to person and solving their problems, and then you come back from commercial and it totally goes this really dark place. So I don't know how that would translate to the stage, but definitely the first half.
When I think back on that episode now, I you know I having watched the show very intensely for a couple years, I sort of feel like I took a break from it after we finished the podcast, mm-hmm. but I still, you know, come back and watch it pretty regularly. And I feel like this episode for me falls into this really like specific category of episode where it's like, there's a handful of episodes that are really good, but I almost don't want to watch them that regularly because mm-hmm. they're like intense, like Eye of the Beholder, mm-hmm. or I just don't want to like ruin them. Like Shadow Play, I think is amazing, but I don't want to watch it every day.
Sure.
And then you have these episodes that I like The Bard, which I'm just like, I never want to watch again. And I would just get up and walk away. But then you have like a bunch of episodes that are kind of like in the middle. They're like very watchable. They're not like so great, but they're just like really, they're just like fun to have on. And I think like What You Need to me is like exactly in the sweet spot of like that kind of episode. Like it doesn't ask a huge amount of you, but it just is kind of a fun, cute little story.
Sure.
I mean, it you know, when I say cute, the character does die. Yes, to be fair.
True. But he's not a nice guy, vibe, so it's okay.
There you go. And his name's Fred, so he probably had it coming.
Nice. There are no Craigs in the Twilight Zone. It pisses really? Me off. I mean, I don't think. I feel like
no. There is a Craig.
The little people.
It's the astronaut little people. Yeah.
All right. I don't think that's his first name, though.
Right.
But good he point. Dies. Yeah. He dies, too.
True. What the hell? Maybe Sterling is trying to tell us something through the ages.
Perhaps. In listening to your episode on What You Need, something that really blew me away, like in that, like everything in the universe is connected and nothing is accidental sort of way, mm-hmm. you made an offhand comment about Fred Renard being a slam poet. Now,
You did
because he has this weird little bit where he says this whole thing and it sounds
like nice clothes, mama, sweet, like I know what you're talking about, yeah, like high living or whatever,
something, yeah.
What satisfies him comes long and low and drives in four wheels, drapes nice and smooth around the shoulders, fits easy, comes from expensive shops, looks uptown, luxury, papa. Luxury.
The listeners don't.
What a witch. Yeah. Sorry.
Nice segue. Sorry. The listeners don't know this yet, but you have graciously agreed to help me launch a brand new segment on the podcast.
I'm the poet, and you're my muse.
That's my poem. I wrote that.
Can you dig it, Daddy O?
This is exactly what it sounds like. It's Twilight Zone poetry. Or specifically, it's poems inspired by Twilight Zone episodes. We're going to do haikus here. Fred, I don't know how much TV you watch, but there's this relatively new show that my wife is obsessed with called Drop the Mic.
I never heard of it.
So it's basically where celebrities, like actors, singers, star fuckers, whatever, face off in like an epic three-round rap battle.
Okay. Interesting.
It's actually kind of fun. We just watched one last night where Kenny G faced off against Richard Marx.
Interesting.
Spoiler alert, Kenny G won.
Oh, I have no doubt about that. Yeah, of course. I mean, I think any musician is going to like have some leg up in that regard, right. I feel like.
So my thinking was it might be fun just to throw down with a few like What You Need specific haikus, and if it works, I might just make it like a permanent segment. I mean, I don't know if it would always be like a battle because it'll probably be me by myself usually throwing out solo haikus most of the time. You know, I mean, unless a certain fellow Twilight Zone podcaster wants to have a recurring role as the haiku guy, which I'd totally be down with.
I'm maybe not like a weekly haiku, but I could be like a seasonal haiku man. Every time the seasons change, I think I can be inspired to come up with a TZ haiku. And I have three tonight, so that's a good rate of return already.
Sounds like an SNL character. Seasonal haiku man.
Seasonal haiku man. Cutting room floor SNL. Character.
And I mean, really, I mean, your fans, I'm sure, are dying for more Fred, right? I mean, because this exactly. monthly thing is just cruel.
Exactly. And really what everybody wants from the Twilight Pwn is more haikus.
That's right. In my typical half-ass fashion, I didn't really think this through. I don't know how we'll determine who won. I don't know. I guess in my head, it was just like, you know, one of us would go. We'd do three. that was kind of where it ended. I don't know.
All right. Well, let's just throw them out there.
Let's roll.
And
yeah.
Kind of see what happens.
I mean, and I'm so, more than happy to concede defeat if I come up short. So
okay. I think we'll be a gentleman's agreement to be very conscientious in our grading of this haiku right. battle.
So I've got.
So should five. I go first? Or you want to go first?
Five. So I have to just pick okay. three here.
Pick your three best. All right.
Okay. You're the guest. I insist that you go first.
Okay. Here you go. Here's my number one. Pedot, what you need is not slip shoes for Renard. You need a new name. Is that all right?
Is that a haiku?
It is, yes. It's 575, right?
That 575, yeah, yeah.
Yeah. Boom. Boom. Slam jam.
Okay. All right. Pedot is a gleep. Peddling is a young man's game. Lou Bookman's cousin?
That's good. I like that one. Gleep mention.
Yeah, I had to drop a gleep in.
Solid. Yeah, and also another callback to another episode. So bonus points for that. All right, here's my number two. Can a bus ticket to Scranton, Pennsylvania really be good luck? I mean, you have to see the episode to understand that one. So I recommend you, listeners, check out the episode before they listen to this.
Have you ever been to Scranton? Because I have not.
God, I want to say that I have, but I don't think I've ever, spent time there.
I mean, I know nothing.
I feel like I have because I've watched The Office a lot, but other than that, not really. It just seems like a bad place.
Yes.
Or not a bad place, but, maybe a place that you don't want to get a bus ticket to.
But they apparently have a baseball team.
Apparently. This is
right. All right.
All right.
Rain-covered sidewalk. Boulevard of broken dreams. Damn these slippery shoes.
That's good. It's very literal, just recounting what happened.
I violated the rhyme scheme a little bit because my third line has six, but I actually did the slippery. Like, with the apostrophe?
Oh, slippery, right. Yeah. No, no, you didn't. And it's funny you should mention that, because I was wondering, okay, so in my last one, the second line is, to Scranton, Pennsylvania, but is it Vania, or Pennsylvania, it could be four, or it could be three, Pennsylvania, what do you think?
I think you can do Vania. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. I'll give you that. Yeah.
It's a local dialect.
There you go.
All right. All right. Here's my number three. Pedot, do you have booze in there? Because if you don't, false advertising.
Okay. And it's funny because normally when I'm recording, I have a big bottle of water. But
okay.
But it's Sunday, so I've been drinking all day. So I've got a couple bottles of beer sitting here. So that's what I need.
There you go.
That's
sounds like you've got what you need.
That's what I need. Okay. Here's my number three. Mr. Fred Renard, a parasitic douchebag. Serling's not a fan.
There you go. What's Serling's intro in the beginning of this
one? Oh my God. It is.
Is it the
It is the.
Is it the cheap man, or that's $4?
Let's see. He's a cheap man. He's a sour man. He's got a chip on his shoulder the size of the national debt.
Oh yeah.
I think it's his worst. His worst most vicious rundown of any of his characters.
Yeah. He comes in real hard on that, and then also the nervous man in a $4 room. But I think Fred Renard gets it good.
Yeah. Well, I mean, Jackie's not a bad guy. I think
that's true. But I always remember John was particularly good. This is just going down memory lane here, but John was particularly good at kind of playing on that. I remember his parody of one of those was poor STD encrusted quarters pay for his room, or cheap little hair or something. I know John was just good at mocking that quality of Serling.
Cheap little hair.
Cheap little fingers, and cheap little hair. Awesome. Yeah, so I don't know. I think we're both kind of the winners there.
So we're gonna call that a draw. We're gonna call it.
I think it's a draw, and I think next season I'll be back, and we'll do.
I was gonna say, we'll know what that means, right? If we're gonna call it a tie, that means we need a tiebreaker. So we're gonna have to come back, and maybe next time we'll have somebody on hand to, like, you know, moderate and judge.
Yeah, I think you know, we can get a family member, a kid, a grandkid, a dog. We can get a judge in here.
Well, you know who I'm thinking of is Reba Wissner.
Oh yeah,
she was
that's a good call.
Already on earlier on this episode talking about the music from What You Need.
Oh, that's cool. What is the music? Is it stock cues or is it an original score?
It's an original score by Van Cleve. He did more original scores than anybody else.
Really?
I mean, I think that if you factor in all the library stuff, I think probably Bernard Herrmann has the most.
Yeah.
But as far as original scores written for the show, Van Cleve's got the most. I think he has like 12.
Oh, interesting.
In fact,
did he? What?
When I talked with Steve Rubin recently.
Oh yeah, yeah.
So did you?
Yes. Yeah. Well, I may have conducted the interview before you, but certainly didn't edit it before you got yours out.
That's how I felt about when Tom's like, "Oh God damn it!"
Well, you know, Tom's gonna scoop everybody.
Yeah, basically, yeah. But when I got the Twilight Zone Encyclopedia, which, by the way, kids, is a great Christmas gift.
Pick it up.
Yeah.
With a lot of photography by none other than Craig Dean.
I did contribute a bit, I'm proud to say. I was flipping through, you know, just looking for things. It's like, oh, is this in here? And is this in here? And so far, it was like, everything's in here. This is insane. And I'm kind of a fan of Van Cleve stuff. So I'm like, Van Cleve. There's no Van Cleve. I'm like,
really?
Okay, is it under C for Cleve? Is Van like a middle name? I don't know. It's not there.
That's actually an interesting question. Maybe Van is a first name, but it's not.
There's no Van Cleve. So I actually brought this up when I talked to him, and he was on his computer, so he pulled up like an earlier draft where he had an entry of Van Cleve, but it was one of the things that got chopped as he was editing.
Yeah, no, I believe it. I feel like I don't know if you listened to our interview, but
not yet.
I was hoping he would have some inside dirt on the actor who played JoJo on Thursday Leave for Home, Danny Kulick, but he was like, no, I think Danny disappeared, and I'm like, oh no, my friend, he's a heart surgeon in Van Nuys, I found him. I was not able to get him on the phone, but I found him.
I mean, you may need to like have a cardiac incident to like,
yeah,
to, like exactly. Get him in a room, but... You know.
Yeah, well, I'm going to California over Christmas, so maybe that'll be an opportunity for me to have a little accident.
Because, you know, that's how you should spend your Christmas holiday.
Well, the truth is out there, Craig.
Tracking down JoJo. Oh, my God.
Cool. Well, I unfortunately got to go. It's funny because we're talking about this episode so much, and it's a lot of wet, slick sidewalks out there, and my name is Fred, but I got to go walk my dog, so...
All right.
I'm hoping I don't bump into any smarmy peddlers.
Yeah. All right. Well, hey, man, thanks a lot for hanging out. I appreciate it.
Not at all. Thanks for having me.
All right. Take care.
Cool. Bye. Bye.
Now that was a severely truncated version of a much longer convo between Fred and myself. And I just can't let all that juicy Fred content go to waste, because when you get Fred on your podcast, you naturally want to milk every single drop out of it. So stay tuned, kids, because I'll be releasing our chat in its entirety as a bonus episode in a few days. You are welcome. Just don't forget to leave a plate of cookies out for me tonight. You know, because I'm basically Santa Claus. Well, gang, it's been fun, but it's Christmas Eve, so we probably all have family-type obligations we need to be getting to. I wish each and every one of you the merriest of Christmases and the happiest of holidays. Thanks again to Reba and Fred for hanging out with us, and of course, thanks to all of you for listening. Stay warm, stay safe, and we'll see you in 2018, kids. And as always, play nice. You don't want to end up on the naughty list, right?
light and shadow.
Guys, as I was about to lock this episode of the podcast, I got the heartbreaking news that Dominic Frontiere passed away on December 21st, just a few days ago. Now, if that name doesn't ring a bell, well, shame on you, because he was the composer of all the music in the legendary first season of The Outer Limits. Now, this is, of course, a Twilight Zone podcast, but we definitely bump up against The Outer Limits on a pretty regular basis. So, as an addendum to our holiday episode this year, I'd like to acknowledge his passing by playing one of his original Outer Limits scores. It's not one of his better-known works, but it actually plays quite nicely along the Van Cleef score for What You Need. So, as an after-the-fact bonus, please enjoy Dominic Frontiere's score in its entirety from the Outer Limits episode Controlled Experiment. Thanks to Mr. Frontiere for an amazing body of work, and rest in peace, good sir.
Thank you.